You're listening to Convenience Matters, brought to you by NACS. Whether it's for food, fuel, drinks, or snacks, about half of the U.S. population shops at a convenience store every day. We'll talk about what we see at stores and what the future may hold for our industry.
Hurricanes. Well, unless you're a storm chaser, you're probably not excited when they're on the horizon. Actually, hurricane season in the Atlantic Ocean runs from June 1st to technically November 30th. Now, on a large scale, they bring massive repercussions to lives and in the communities they impact. In this specific episode of Convenience Matters, we will actually discuss their effect on the oil and fuel market, and more importantly, on your retail operations. Welcome to Convenience Matters. My name is Donovan Woods with the Fuels Institute, and I'm joined today by my co-host.
Hey guys, this is John Eichberger with NACS and the Fuels Institute. And you know, Donovan, I'm excited today because we're going to be talking to a couple of individuals who really have their finger on the pulse of the weather situation in the Gulf Coast and how it impacts the markets for the fuels industry. Let's welcome Jim Foster, the chief meteorologist, and Brian Mild, the editor of and product manager at DTN. Gentlemen, welcome to Convenience Matters.
Thank you.
So this has been a pretty active year already. I mean, I think right now we're at the middle of September, towards the end of September, and we are now on tropical storm named Beta. So we've already gone through the alphabet A to Z, and now we're into the Greek alphabet. Is, from what you guys have seen, is this abnormal, or is this, should we be thinking, wow, this is a much more active season, or what's really kind of going on here?
From the storm point, certainly active, it's the most active since 2005. I could let Jim respond more to that. On the fuel side, you know, we've seen some disruptions to support price, with, you know, some disruptions which has slowed supply movements in some areas, but it hasn't been as bad as it could have been, considering demand has been down because of COVID. So that has been a factor diminishing its impact on consumers. But certainly some areas have been hard hit. Like if you look in the Louisiana area especially, you know, they're still struggling with power outages. And that has impacted some oil refineries and chemical plants and other activity in that area. But overall, the effect of the fuel market this year hasn't been too terrible. Especially, like I said, when you compare to, you know, 2005 with Hurricane Katrina and all the storms then, and even Hurricane Harvey during 2017, which was pretty catastrophic for the Houston area. So,
would you attribute the lower than previously experienced impact on the fuels market? Is that attributed to the reduced demand because of COVID, or is it because the industry has put in place various measures to become a little more resilient when there's a potential disruption?
That's absolutely true, that latter part. With the industry is far more resilient than it was 15 years ago when Katrina hit. Certainly even back then, you know, the industry would have struggled in many ways, but they learned a lot. They've learned in the various storms that have happened year after year. You know, you're throwing Superstorm Sandy's another one to bring into it. They've taken measures such as adding generators to various pumping stations, which means that if there's trouble at one part of the pipeline, it won't affect the entire pipeline. They've also have done things like rerouting product. So you know, when you look at it, there's a massive pipeline called the Colonial Pipeline that runs with the Houston, Pasadena, you know, area, all the way, you know, up to Linden, New Jersey. It feeds the Southeast product especially. And what they've done is at times if one of the lines are impacted, they've moved some product on the other line just to get the supplies up to where it's needed. They've also even have built a problem of fire where a backhoe had hit a pipeline back in 2016, hit part of the pipeline, and they even rerouted some, made a temporary pipeline around that section to continue to deliver product to consumers. They're ingenious in what they do. And when you look at the industry overall as well, there's also a response by imports. So we did see, imports moving into the affected areas that will limit the impact on those communities. So the response by the industry is outstanding. I mean, they're extraordinary professionals in getting the product to where it's needed.
Sometimes when we don't see something as catastrophic as Katrina or Sandy or was it Harvey in Houston a few years ago, that doesn't mean that the season isn't as dramatic as it looks like it is for meteorologists. So what is it about this season that's different than maybe other seasons?
It's primarily the sheer volume of storms through today. There's been 23 named storms, and that's really the earliest we've done that, and the earliest we've hit many of those milestones. And so the sheer number of storms therefore increases the likelihood that they'll be landfall, and there's been 9 of them so far. So the combination of a lot of storms and the fact that we've had 9 storms, and that hasn't happened in many, many, many years, that hasn't given us a break, if you will, between these storms, and particularly in the Gulf Coast area. So that's really been the big difference, is the sheer volume. We haven't had that gigantic Category 5 storm yet, although in 2005 we hadn't had it yet either. So they can still got plenty of time left, as you mentioned.
You know, Jim, I had somebody ask me, I told them we were going to be having this conversation. They said, hey, can you ask this question? You know, has there been a change in the criteria for what storm levels are being named? The question is, if we have 23 named storms, are those storms still the same level of intensity as they used to be, or have we changed the threshold at which we actually name a storm?
No, nothing has changed, certainly since, 2005. There's criteria for a storm to be identified and examined, and then there's certainly the progression through the getting a name and the categories of hurricanes. But no, there hasn't been any significant changes, and there's just, if you recall, this year was forecast to be a very active year, due to a variety of atmospheric and oceanic stuff. And that has indeed transpired. So this shouldn't be a surprise. The fact that there's been 9 landfalling and, 23 storms is difficult to forecast that. But all the indications were that there was going to be above average year in the Atlantic and Gulf. And that certainly has panned out.
So, Brian, one of the things that we've been asked over the years, when you're in the fuels industry, a hurricane makes landfall in Louisiana or Texas, and then when there's a tight supply situation, you start having some price movements in regions very distant from the impacted zone, And we used to get questions when I was a lobbyist from Congress. I don't understand why a hurricane hits Louisiana and the fuel prices and supplies in New England are compromised. That didn't make any sense. Can you walk us through a little bit how the system operates, and from the DTN perspective and the data you guys have access to, what you are looking for to kind of figure out the impact of a storm fall on the overall supply and demand for fuels?
Sure, absolutely. So when these storms are coming, first thing, the market is aware of them. They're storms can be tricky. It might move, take different patterns, but the market is aware of them. So what you tend to see, the industry gearing up as quick as they can to produce as much supply and move that, not get any supply caught up on pipelines or in terminals, try to move it out to market, right before the landfall happens. Of course, there's going to be a response by price, because the you're aware that you have a storm, if it's going and it's going to damage some production capacity or movement of supply, it's going to affect price. So you do see that response. And when you people tend not to understand how, you know, the fuels markets work. I mean, for oil is traded internationally. So if something actually happens in Libya or in Iran, it does affect, you know, our prices in the United States. But when you take it down to looking more, you know, at the fuel side, you know, the majority of our supply is produced, you know, by refineries in the United States. But refineries aren't, you know, located. Every state doesn't have a refinery. They're concentrated, you know, in the Gulf Coast area, in the Texas, Louisiana area, namely. You have more than, you know, half the refining capacity in that location. And they're the most sophisticated refineries in the world. But what happens is they move up pipelines. You know, some do, are shipped, you know, to areas like Florida. But essentially, you know, the majority of that supply is moved up pipelines. They go from Houston up to the Chicago markets. They go through the Southeast and up to the New York markets. And they're critical in supply in those regions. So what happens is, you know, if you have a disruption down in, you know, in the Houston area, and we've had them before, the market's going to anticipate, you know, lower supply. And if you have less supply and demand is strong, you know, prices are going to move up. It's a very natural phenomenon. And prices are the way the market's priced on the wholesale side is you have a financial side of it. You have what they call a futures contract. And the country's essentially broken into seven major regions. It's a little bit, you know, different. We can get to those details another time, but essentially seven major regions called spot markets. And those spot markets will base their price on what's going off the futures market. If they trade in a basis or what's called a cash differential. So in other words, if we're looking at the futures market and it's at $2, and, you know, maybe the gasoline in the Gulf Coast was trading maybe a nickel, you know, 5 cents under that, so $1.95. If you have a storm hitting that area and closing refining capacity, maybe that nickel discount goes up to a 10 cent premium. So now you have a 15 cent, you know, jump in that price. But what also happens is your futures contract is going to respond to that and increase, you know, rapidly. And we see that all the time. On the other hand, too, you know, we've also seen when the market thought there was going to be a hit with a hurricane, and then it dissipates or it moves away from refining capacity. We've also seen those moves come down as quickly as possible. As these supplies are moving also along the pipelines and you're getting to those locations, you know, you have there's hundreds of terminals in the country. These are distribution areas that are mostly off of pipelines. Some are by water areas or by refineries, and what happens is the supply is moving to these terminals, but if the supply is disrupted and there's less available inventory, you know, you will see those suppliers raise their prices because they're reflecting the supply demand balance, and that's just, that is an appropriate price response. When you see that happen, you're also going to see the chance of maybe making what they call an arbitrage favorable, in which supply from another part of the world might be coming over to the country because they see that price signal to help offset that. But hurricanes are usually a little more fast moving than that. So typically what you'll see is, you know, terminals, you'll see a lot of activity at terminals where suppliers are trying to move that product, you know, from the distribution terminals to the retail outlets. And then, you know, if there is a disruption or they're shut down because of a power outage or something like that, you just won't see any supply movement from there. You know, that's essentially what you see. I don't know if I answered your question properly.
No, that was great. Thanks.
Thank you, Brian. And, you know, Jim, I had another question. I think I'm just kind of geeking out a little bit because my cousin is a meteorologist and I kind of love the field myself. And I thought I could have been one back in the day, but that didn't work out. So just from a meteorologist standpoint, when you look at what retailers or fuel retailers, specifically convenience store owners, have to deal with, they don't leave. They're there when this happens, when this doesn't happen. They have to be around the last person there for the residents to be able to come to depend on. So being prepared is a very big thing for them. Is there anything, and you may not have an answer for this from your point of view, but is there anything that could keep them aware? Do you have anything at DTN? Is there a specific site that retailers could go to kind of keep aware with what's happening in the area with the weather patterns?
Sure. There's a first of all, it's not too late. You can still become a meteorologist if you want.
I appreciate that. We'd welcome.
No, there's a we have a subscription weather service that users have a certain amount of seats and licenses and mobile applications and so forth. Depends on where they are and what their operation is, but largely they're in communication a lot with our meteorologists. That's the most important thing when these storms start to form in the Gulf or even threaten the Gulf, as Brian mentioned, they're making decisions days in advance about rerouting or getting the right supply chain, in place. So there's not interruptions or not too many interruptions. And so the consultation part of this is one of the most valuable things. We'll typically on conference calls with several different entities, you know, safety, operations, logistics, all different parts of the value chain that are affected by a big storm, and they've all got decisions to make, and they're very important and costly ones. So they don't want to just look at a website generally. That's where they get information. High level information, but it's like getting a tap on the shoulder. It's time to start talking to the humans. And we're advising them on storm surge and the rainfall with these slow moving storms. That's one of the biggest problems and one of the reasons why flooding is the biggest threat in tropical systems. Not the winds or trees falling. It's people that get caught in floods. So we've heard a lot about the storm surge this year, and that's really basically the ground flooding, and then on top of that, there's all the rain. We've had feet of rain at a couple of these storms. Right. It's just crazy to talk about that. So the flooding is something that they really need to keep an eye on, and not not take a chance or assume that you can survive in a situation. A lot of times you get cut off from the rest of the world, if you will, if you're near the coast. And that's the hazard. It could happen for days after the storm is gone and that you can't get out or they can't get to you. And those kind of things are very dangerous. So, there's not much you can really do. It's going to come and you just have to be prepared as best you can for the heavy rain and flooding, which persists for days on end, and sometimes weeks after the rain ends. Wow.
All right, Jim. So here's the question. Since you're the meteorologist, and what is your forecast for the remainder of the hurricane season? Should we be expecting some big whammies, or should we expect kind of a petering out before the end of the year?
No pressure.
That's a good question. All the reasons why we were forecasting an active year are all still there. And, I think people, when it's warm in the summer, everybody thinks of hurricanes in June and so forth into July. And now that it's fall officially, you don't normally think of them, but we do revert back to that 2005 season. That's the only one we've had in our lifetimes that's been close to what we're having right now. And we didn't even have the strongest storm of the year yet. That was Wilma.
Wow.
Strongest ever, as a matter of fact, in the Atlantic, the most intense hurricane we ever had. And that was in October. And it crossed Cozumel, the Yucatan, and into Florida. And that wasn't like almost a month from now that happened. And then I don't want to get anybody too mad, but we also had a storm over Christmas that year that lasted until 2006, so it went over the new year. So
at least you're one in them.
Even though that the season has peaked, we're by no means done with it, and I'm afraid we're going to have more activity, and it could be significant.
Wow. So just one last question from me too. I would think, Brian, you may have the answer for this one, but if not, Jim, feel free to jump in. What would you tell fuel retailers, convenience store owners, specifically in terms of those who have to be there? They're not going to leave their communities. What could you tell them in terms of just being prepared and making sure that they take care of themselves and as well as their customers?
I'll start and cover the weather part. Be ready to be self-sufficient for days. That probably means electricity, water, food. I guess if you're a convenience store, you probably got that covered. But you have to be ready to not have all the normal things. You might not even have Wi-Fi and things like that. So you have to be prepared as possible for, you know, less than ideal conditions. While first responders are perhaps focusing on other areas, neighborhoods or you know, primary care facilities, things that they want to get to first. So, you know, stock up and be ready for, rather, primitive couple days, potentially, would be my advice.
Yeah, and I would say, add to that, retailers should stay in close contact with their suppliers, just making sure they have enough fuel so they don't run out. That may be unavoidable in certain systems, but I think if you maintain a close relationship with your supplier or suppliers, you're in a better position to ensure you're pushing fuel out. And I think the communications is important, making sure you know who to contact if you have a problem, whether it be the authorities or whoever. If you're a store as part of a regional or national chain, make sure you're in close contact with people that can make decisions. Take things seriously. It's easy to try to be a John Wayne or be a real hero, but just storms are not something to play around with. And if you're in a convenience store, you also have to deal with electricity. Shock yourself, your fuel problems. I mean, there's a lot of, it could be potentially dangerous things at a store if you're not prepared. And I guess a lot of that's just common sense. And I'm sure these fuel supply convenience owners and operators are aware of that. But that would be my recommendation.
Donovan, you started off the broadcast talking about how hurricanes affect local communities and individuals. And, Brian and Jim just gave some great advice for the stores that are in the hurricane paths. But what I'm getting out of the conversation, the big picture, is the fuel sector is so much more prepared and able to recover from disruptions than it was in the past, that we've been able to shore up our infrastructure to ensure that we can continue to deliver transportation energy to our customers on pretty quickly after a storm fall, and that the impact broader than the affected community has been mitigated to a degree. And that's because the industry has stepped up and done a lot to improve the infrastructure and protect it against a disruption, all for the purpose of serving the customers. And that's a huge advancement over 15 years ago when everything was thrown topsy-turvy when Katrina and Rita hit landfall and the markets went absolutely crazy.
Absolutely. That's exactly what I'm picking up on. And I guess at this point, we appreciate you, Brian and Jim, for joining us. Again, excited to have DT and be a part of this Convenience Matters episode. And I appreciate your insight. I'm looking forward to what happens in the rest of this season. And as John mentioned, we are assured that our fuel retailers, our convenience store owners are prepared. They will not be caught off guard, and they have resources such as yourselves at DCN to help them be prepared, as well as at NACS. So thank you both for being a part of this episode of Convenience Matters.
Thank you.
Excellent.
Thank you.
And thank you for listening to Convenience Matters.
Convenience Matters is brought to you by NACS and produced in partnership with Human Factor. For more information, visit convenience.org.